Hi, my name is Anthony, and I'm going to show you how to get started using Stitch. In this video, I'll walk you through the process of setting up an integration, setting up a destination, and moving your first rows of data using Stitch. The whole process only takes a few minutes, but works best if you have all of your credentials ready to go. To make the setup process easier, you can add a team member from within your Stitch account. So let's get started. Here's my browser homepage, and you can see that I've got bookmarks for HubSpot and Stitch. So let's go to HubSpot first, so you can see the data we'll be moving into our destination. The first thing I'll need to do is log into my HubSpot account that I created earlier and show you the data that we'll be moving into our data warehouse. If I go to Contacts, you'll see that HubSpot sets us up with a couple of sample contacts. For this demo, I'll only be moving these two rows of data to our destination, but you can use Stitch to move millions or even billions of rows of data each month. I'm going to log out of my HubSpot account so we can see how Stitch handles authentication when we're adding our integration. Signing up for Stitch is really simple. First, I'll enter my email address and click Sign Up for Free. Then, I'll add a little bit of information about myself. And then I'll choose a password. Now that I've completed the signup form, it's time to choose an integration. Stitch has over 100 integrations to choose from out of the box, and you can see that it's a pretty long list. So let's use the search functionality. One cool thing about search is that if you happen to come across an integration that we don't support, you can suggest an integration, learn about the Singer framework behind Stitch, or you can learn about our enterprise plan, where we'll build and maintain integration for you. Now let's get started with HubSpot. Setting up an integration is really easy. First thing we'll need to do is give this integration a name, so let's call it Stitch Video. Depending on the integration, you'll have certain additional options available. This option here allows you to change how far back you'd like to start syncing data from. For now, we'll use a default of 30 days. You can also choose how often you'd like to sync data. For HubSpot, this can be as often as every 30 minutes. By choosing Advanced, I can use a cron expression to create a highly customized schedule. But for now, I'll be using the default for this as well. And now I can go ahead and click Authorize. To authorize, I just need to log into my HubSpot account, and Stitch will check to make sure that it can connect to our account. Once it connects, we will see our list of tables that we can sync. From here, I can click in and out of different tables. After you're done setting things up, you'll be able to come back and add or remove tables and fields. I'm only interested in tracking contacts for now, so I'll go back and click on that. I can select the individual fields to sync one by one, or I can click this box and select Track All Fields. Since this is the only table I'm interested in for now, I'll hit Finalize and Continue. Now it's time to set up a destination. Setting up Redshift is a bit more involved, but I'll walk you through the basic steps needed to get started. You'll need full access to an AWS account to follow along with this video. For more information, check out the Stitch docs and Amazon's documentation on getting started with Redshift. From our destination page, I'll click on Redshift. And here's a look at some of the fields we'll need to fill out. There's a bit of setup involved, and so I'll go to our Stitch docs to walk me through that. There are a few things you'll need first. Full permissions to an AWS account and an up and running Redshift instance, which I'm going to start up in a second. If you need to get a teammate involved, you can invite them from the configuration page we were just on. I'll be using a direct connection in this video, but there's also a section that covers an SSH tunnel. This section guides you through the setup steps, but first we'll need to log into our AWS account. In a new tab, I'll navigate to aws.amazon.com and click My Account and then AWS Management Console. I'll sign in with my email and password. From the homepage, I'll go to Services, and then under Databases, go to Amazon Redshift. In this page, I'll go to Clusters, and then I'll click on Create Cluster. For this demo, I'll use DC2 Large, but you can learn more about the other options on the AWS website. I'll use the default username and create a password. I won't be using an IAM role, but you can learn more about this on the AWS site. For this quick demo, I'll be using all the default settings, so I can just click Create Cluster. It can take a few minutes for the cluster to get created, so I'm going to speed things up here. And once that's available, you can go into your cluster and go to Properties. Here's your endpoint, which we'll need later. And we'll also need the database name, the port number, and the username. But first, we need to make a few changes so that this can all work with Stitch. First thing I'll do is make it publicly accessible. This can take a few moments as well, but once it's done, you can go back to Properties and see that it now says yes. The next thing we'll need to do, which is outlined in the docs, is whitelist the necessary IP addresses. I'll click on this link under VPC Security Group to open it in a new tab. From here, I'll click on Create Security Group and then refer back to the docs to walk me through what I need to do. So we just got through Create Security Group, and now we need to give it a name, description, and check the VPC. I'll just put Stitch and Stitch, and check that the VPC matches the one for our cluster. And now I can start adding rules. I'll go back to our docs to help me out here. I need to choose custom TCP rule and port 5439. And I'll copy the first IP address and paste it under source. And I'm just going to go ahead and do this for the rest of the IP addresses. All the IP addresses are listed in our Stitch docs. Now once I'm done, I'll just check to make sure it was created. And now we can see it here. And now I'll check back with our Stitch docs. So we wrapped up this part. And now we need to create a Redshift user. Before I do that though, I'll just add the security group we just created. I'll click Edit, and then add the security group called Stitch. And once that's done, we can go back to the properties and see that both security groups are now there. And now we can move on to creating a Stitch database user. To do this, I'll go to the query editor and log in using the database name and master username for our Redshift cluster, which were found on the properties page. In the query editor, I'll run a few statements, which are all found in our docs. Some of these queries take a few seconds to run, and so you'll notice that I'll speed things up in the video a bit. The first statement is to create a user called Stitch, and you'll just need to fill in a secure password. Once that's done, I'll comment it out and get the next statement from our docs. This next one here is to give the Stitch user create permissions. And we just need to fill in the database name here. And then we can run it. And finally, we just need to grant select permissions with these two last statements here. And now, it's time to start filling out the destination form. So, we'll need this endpoint here. Just be sure to delete the port number and the database name, which is everything including and after the colon. We'll need the master username and password. And our database name. And we took care of this part earlier, so we can just check and save. Once this is done, we'll be ready to move our first rows of data. In our dashboard, we'll see any integrations that we've added. Here's the one we created earlier. From the integration page, we'll see basic information about any extractions and loads currently taking place. We can add new tables to track, view extraction logs, which show data that has been taken from your source but not yet loaded, and we can review loading reports. There's already an extraction running, but if we clicked Run Extraction Now, it would kick off a job immediately. This process can take a few minutes, so I'm going to skip ahead. Four minutes later, we can see our first batch has completed. If we go to the query editor in our AWS console and click Refresh, we'll see that a new schema has been created called Stitch Video. And here, we can see the contacts table that was just moved over using Stitch. And if we run a select statement, we can see that the data is now available in a Redshift data warehouse. From here, you can connect more sources so that you can start joining, aggregating, and transforming your data using Redshift. You can also connect a BI tool to do deeper analysis and start getting insights from your data. I hope this video is helpful, and I hope you're feeling ready to get started using Stitch.